So let's do another example. And in this example, we're going to look at PCl5. In PCl5, our central atom is going to be phosphorus. In that phosphorus, we're going to have 5 valence electrons. For chlorine, each of them contributes 1 electron, and there's 5 of them. So this is going to give us a total of 10 electrons, which are 5 pairs. All 5 of these pairs are going to be bonding pairs, and we're going to have 0 lone pairs. If we have 0 lone pairs, this means our electron domain geometry is going to equal our molecular geometry, which is going to equal a trigonal bipyramid. In this trigonal bipyramid molecule, our hybridization is going to be a little bit different. We're expanding the octet, so the s and the p orbitals are only going to be able to accommodate 4 bonds. So this expanded octet has to have some d orbital character. So since we have 5 pairs, we need to have an sp3d hybridization. And now we can draw this particular molecule with a phosphorus in the center with 5 ligands around it, or 5 electron domains. Each of them is going to contain a chlorine, and the chlorines are going to have a full octet. But the phosphorus is going to have an expanded octet. And if we look at this particular molecule, since all 5 ligands are the same, we're going to have 5 vectors pulling in equal and opposite directions. So this will be a nonpolar molecule. Let's look at another example. In this case, we'll look at SF6. Our central atom in this case is sulfur. Sulfur as a central atom has 6 valence electrons. The fluorine contributes 1 electron to the center, and there's 6 of them. So we're going to have a total of 12 electrons and 6 pairs. There are 6 sulfur fluorine bonds, so we're going to have 6 bonding pairs and 0 lone pairs. If we have 6 pairs, that means we have to expand beyond an octet. So we're going to have an sp3d2 hybridization around the central atom. In this particular case, since we have 0 lone pairs, our electron domain geometry is going to equal our molecular geometry, and that's going to be an octahedron. And when we draw this molecule, it's going to look something like this. And all of our bond angles are going to be 90 degrees from each other. So let's do one more example of this type. And in addition to doing neutral molecules, we can also look at charge species. For example, NH4+. Our central atom is nitrogen. Nitrogen is going to have 5 valence electrons. Next, we have hydrogen. Hydrogen, there's going to be 4 of them, each contributing one electron each. If at this point we added up all the electrons, we would have 9 electrons, which would not be good in trying to form an octet. So what happens is, with this positive charge, we have to subtract one electron, because by becoming a positive charge, we are getting rid of that electron. This is why NH4 is a positive 1 charge, because there's a total of 9 electrons here. We subtract 1, we get 8 total electrons and 4 pairs. Of these pairs, 4 of them are going to be bonding pairs, 0 are going to be lone pairs. So our electron domain geometry is going to equal our molecular geometry, and this is going to be a tetrahedron. The hybridization, since we have 4 pairs, is going to be sp3. So when we draw this molecule, we have to draw its tetrahedral geometry, and we also have to indicate that this particular molecule has a positive 1 charge. In order to do that, typically we put the molecule in brackets, like I've done, and we put the positive charge right out here. In this case, we have 4 of the same ligand, so its bond angle is going to be 109.5 degrees. And since all 4 ligands are the same, this is going to be nonpolar. So these are various examples of drawing the shapes of the molecules, determining their electron domain, molecular geometry, the bond angles, whether they're polar or nonpolar, and looking at the hybridization about the central atom in molecules where we have the ligand being a halogen, a hydrogen, or a hydroxide group. In the next video, we'll take a look at the case when our ligand is either oxygen or sulfur.